Savior. No doubt about it. Amen? That's why I'm here this morning. Thank you, brother. Well, praise the Lord. For those that were able to join us, it was beautiful to be out there in the prayer gazebo. And, you know, I pray that, I believe God has given us that gift. Amen? So I pray that this body will enjoy and use that gazebo and, you know, find comfort there, find strength there, find peace there, whatever you need. I believe you can find it there. I believe God will meet you and you will find it in that prayer gazebo. Amen. Well, bless the Lord. Well, this morning, if you've seen the title, which my brother had to remind me, it's actually a song. I don't know if some of you old Bible folk or old church folk, it's a song I know we sang growing up. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. You know, let that be the spirit in which we come to church. We should be running in here. Just like when we were out in that gazebo, that's kind of how I felt. You know, I just was like, hey, and I was all excited and jumped up. Like, can't we enter church that way? I mean, seriously, can't we just come to church, like, excited and, like, you know, ready to go? It's like, I remember when, you know, Mike and I were kids and, you know, after dinner, if you were lucky enough, you might have had a few bucks. Not bucks, what am I saying? Probably a couple of quarters. But if... when Mr. Softy came down the block, man, you were running after the truck. We ought to be running into church like that, like Mr. Softy's here. And he's got a cone with sprinkles for us, amen? That's how it should be, though. Like, and there are days I do feel like that. Now, if I'm honest, church, there are days where I'm like, man, who took my ice cream? We ought to come in still, though, with thanksgiving in our heart and enter his courts with praise. Amen. According to the word of God, according to scripture. And I believe we are, though. I believe, again, when God reveals something, it's because it's happening. It's either happening or getting ready to happen. I believe he's always an on-time God. It's not like, hey, you know, here's this word. I promise you're going to be able to sing in about 6 months or so. Nah, come on. I believe he's doing that, but I believe it is so that we will. We'll be a people of praise and worship. But church, sometimes I don't enter his gates with thanksgiving, and I enter his courts with a complaint, not a praise. And he's like, Phil, you're supposed to come in here with praise. Like, can I hear the praise first? We'll get to the complaint soon enough. But you got to start with the complaint. And I think God's saying, nope, there's no more time for that. Now there's a time for praise, not a complaint, not a sorrow, not a heartache. Yes, I know you have them. And church, listen, I doubt they're ever going to go away. This just in? I don't. But how we live our life, the things of earth will grow strangely dim. In what? The light of his glory and his grace. Then I can praise. If you know you're under the umbrella of God's grace, can't you praise? Amen. Okay, can you ever escape the umbrella of his grace? Nope. Of course not. Then we ought to praise. And then I think, again, whatever happens on the playing field team, praise the Lord, leave it on the field, but it's under the glory of his grace. And how we respond, I pray it's with thanksgiving and with praise. Whatever circumstance we find ourselves in. Whether it's personally, whether it's corporate, work, church, whatever. You know, God's message isn't just for the 30 minutes on 30 minutes. Pastor, you go a good 45. All right. I think it's more than the 45 on Sunday. I think it's got to be life-changing. I think it's got to be life-altering. Otherwise... church, it's nice that you sing on Sunday, but if you ain't singing and giving thanks Monday to Friday, who cares? The world don't care. And the world don't want none of your church. Because the first thing you got to bring them is that complaint. They ain't, ain't showing up here for that. There's enough of that. Nobody, I'm like, I don't want any more. I'm full, thank you very much. But if we can enter his courts with praise and thanksgiving and know that he is truly sovereign, and just like the song, he is above it all. If we can live with that kind of faith and that kind of understanding, then I think life can look and feel a whole lot different, amen? I'd like to take a look at a piece of scripture. It's in Psalm 17. It's a very familiar passage of scripture. This one is a prayer of David's. And, you know, many of the Psalms are generally just David's life, ups and downs. But in most of those ups and downs, in the goods and the bads, he always knew to go to God first. He always knew to go to the prayer gazebo first and lift it to God. I believe David would have ran to that, up to that gazebo, jumped up, high-fived it, and then went in and entered that courts of praise, no matter what. And often, many of the Psalms will show you that. You can see the heart of David. I can picture him doing that. Like, I don't know if you're like me. I always try and picture like a David, an Isaiah, or a Peter, or, you know, what do these guys look like? What do they dress like? What were their mannerisms? Like, were they smooth, or were they just kind of clunking along? Like, what were they? No, am I the only crazy guy thinking that stuff? But anyway, David here says in verse 1, he says, "Hear the right, O Lord. Attend unto my cry. Give ear unto my prayer that goeth not out of feigned lips." So what's David doing here? I believe David entered into the prayer gazebo, and he's taking his appeal to a higher court. That's essentially the opening here. It's an appeal. It's talking about, you know, an appearance in a courtroom. He's taking it to a higher authority. Church, if the church won't take life, the challenges, the circumstances to the higher court, who's going to take it to the higher court? No one's going to take it to the higher court. And he has an appeal here. Sometimes we've got an appeal. What's the appeal? Well, I just don't like the circumstances of my life. I don't like how it shook out. I don't like what's going on in this particular situation. I don't know what it is. And everybody right now, something is rattling through your head, some circumstance in your life that you have an appeal for. You do. Praise God, you should. Now, the question is, will you take it to the higher court? And will you enter his courts with praise? Your Honor, I'm here, and I just came to praise the Lord and praise you and praise the wonderful courtroom. Amen. Does anybody enter the courthouse like that? Get my lawyer, get my facts, get my story. Okay, here's what I'm going to say. You got to swear on the Bible, right, to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? I remember reading a study. They say that 70% of the people that testify in court lie. 70%. Why go to court then? I mean, seriously, why go to court if 70% of the testimony that you're going to hear is going to be a lie? It seems kind of silly to me. But maybe we can, you know, maybe we can take our appeal to a higher court. Now, you know where the courtroom is, right? It's inside of you. Psalms 116 says the court, it's within. It's within. It's never outside of you. The courtroom is inside of you. There's a judge sitting in there. He's just waiting to hear. Will you bring the appeal to him? Will you let him resolve it? That takes some faith. That takes some faith, church, because sometimes I'm like, I don't even know if he's aware of it. No, just me. You guys know he's aware of everything. I'm just the only one questioning that one. Is he really aware of it, this circumstance, this situation? Can I really take this appeal to him? Because sometimes it's insignificant. Sometimes I know I'm being a baby. No, just Pastor Mike and I are the babies in here, you guys. Sometimes I just got my whiny story. But David's saying here, and again, it won't come out of feigned lips. What's he saying when he, listen, don't give me the answer I want to hear. That takes faith, church. Because sometimes the only reason why I'm coming to you is for what reason? I want you to lie to me. I want you to give me the answer I want to hear. No, I'm the only one that said, and you all know, they're like, I know if I go to my brother, 10 out of 10, if I have something that I want to hear, he's not going to tell me. Now, what will he do? He'll tell me. He's going to give me truth. Same thing with my father. Same thing with my mother. The mother phone call was a rare phone call because I knew it was going to be totally draped in faith and nothing else. But then there's certain folks, oh, they'll tell me what I want to hear. Those are feigned lips. Those are feigned lips. David's smart enough to realize that, you know what? Maybe God's going to give me an answer that it's not in my favor. It's just not in my favor. Sometimes we just want the favor, a favor. David knows good and well that favor may actually get him into trouble. No, anybody ever get favor and then realize, oh, I don't really, I thought I wanted it. I really don't want this. Don't let it come out of feigned lips. He's smart enough to know, Lord, just, I got to put it in your hands and know that the appeal I bring to you, well, you're going to deliver the right response, the right answer, the right judgment. And so he's bringing it to the Lord. Verse 2, let my sentence come forth from thy presence. Let thine eyes behold things that are equal. Well, what's David's sentence? Well, it's only going to come from God's presence. It's mercy, church. When God shows up, he's showing up with mercy. That's why David's saying, why else would I go to God? Because I know it's going to be mercy. Now, yes, it will be truth, which sometimes I may not like, but I know it'll always be under the umbrella of mercy. And he knows that the only way that the sentence can come forth, the actual verdict, the actual answer, the only way it can come forth is in mercy, the presence of God, which David knows when his presence shows up, when the presence of God shows up in your life, like, doesn't everything else just kind of drown out? Yes, David knows that. I don't know what his appeal is. I don't know. Some will speculate it was Saul and he's after him, or his son that was wanting to, I don't know. You don't know. So it's not relevant. What's relevant? That God shows up. That mercy shows up in the situation, whatever I find myself in. I know it's your presence, Lord. That's the only thing that's going to help me in this situation. Sometimes, church, it's not about fixing the situation you find yourself in. It's about the answer. Mercy shows up. Then the situation really doesn't matter, whatever it may be. David knows that. We ought to know that. We need to know that. The only thing that really needs to show up in my life in these circumstances, I make my appeal to God, mercy showed up. Can we not, I mean, does anybody want a little more mercy from God? I'll take a little more, thank you, please. You're serving seconds? I'll take a second helping, please. Amen. And he says, let your eyes only behold that which is equal. What's David saying here? Don't tip the scales. It goes back to don't tip the scales in my favor. Only what's equal, only what is right, only what is just. I'm not looking for a crooked path. I'm not looking for an easy path. I'm looking for an equal path. I'm looking for equity. I'm looking for justice. I'm looking for righteousness. What is equal? Boy, how about that prayer? Can we stop praying that prayer? I pray the country starts praying that prayer. Can we be equal? Equal. I don't care what you believe in. I don't care. Can we be equal? Can we not try and tip scales? But sometimes, church, I want to tip the scale. Again, I just want that little bit of favor, just that little bit of edge. Why? Because then I got you. Then you're not equal. Then you're not equal. And God, the truth is, God, I mean, he can only be equal. He can only be just. He says that in Proverbs, right, that the unjust scales are the ones that are out of whack. They're not balanced. They're not equal. He says that's an abomination. God sees that as an abomination. When you see someone not as being your equal, that's an unjust scale. That's a scale out of whack, and that's an abomination. I'm not talking about money, church. We're talking about how we look and see the world and see others around us. And they may believe something totally cockamamie as far as you're concerned. Doesn't matter. When you look at them, you should see equal. Isn't that what's on the Supreme Court, I believe? Equal justice under the law? That's why she's blind. Equal is equal. The scales should always be balanced. We shouldn't be looking to tip the scales in our favor ever. That's a righteous God. Amen.
Amen.
Verse 3. Thou hast proved mine heart. Thou hast visited me in the night. Thou hast tried me and shall find nothing. I am purposed that my mouth shall not transgress. So David knows that, listen, there's a chance here I might want to tip the scales. There's a chance here I might not see somebody equal to me. Lord, please try my heart. Put my heart on trial. Make sure it's right. Make sure it's fair. Make sure it's balanced. Make sure it's equal. Because otherwise, I'm liable to say something stupid. What do you think is transgressing the mouth talking about? Me saying something stupid. You know so-and-so. You know what they think. Well, how do I know what they think? How do you know what they think? Isn't that funny how we actually will pretend to know the thoughts of folks? Oh, I know what they're thinking. How could you know that? Unless you're Jesus Christ, how could you know that? But David's smart enough to pray this prayer that says, listen, don't let my mouth run away from me here. I think it's James that says that the perfect man is the one that will not offend in word. You want to be a perfect person? Zip your mouth. Just zip your mouth. I got nothing to add to this. Zip it. That's the perfect man. The perfect man doesn't declare that they're a sinner or that they're jacked up or that they, you want to know what they're thinking? That's not the perfect man. That's the imperfect man. But he's asking the Lord to try him. And how does the Lord try us, by the way? I think there's life circumstances, but ultimately it's the word of God that will try you. Because we can twist all we want in life, and we can twist our own feelings, our own thoughts, and we can tip the scales and say they're not really tipped. But you can't tip this. You can't change this. It won't lie to you. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
The only thing that can try me, because sometimes even though I know my brother will speak truth and my father will speak truth, I don't want to listen to them. I can show them attitude and just ignore them. You can't do that with the word of God. Because it's like, it won't talk back. It won't fight you. It won't argue with you. And then when you look at it, it's still going to say the same thing I told you the first time. Amazing how that happens. Like, wait a second. Yeah, no, it didn't change. Anybody's Bible changing on them? This tries me. It's right every time. And God does it, and I believe, in such a gentle and kind and just such an amazing way, I believe. He does. David knows this. David knew God's word. David found it precious. Held on to that. And he knew that ultimately it would show him what was right. Because sometimes we don't know what's right. Sometimes, church, I don't know what's right. But I know where to go. And God is good. God is faithful. God is good. Whether that's a prayer gazebo, whether that's showing up here on Sunday, whether that's you just having a cup of coffee at your dining room table, or you're actually reading the Word of God in the morning. I pray the church is reading the Word of God sometime throughout the week. Amen? Yeah, David realizes this, and he's saying, Lord, help me. Because sometimes I know my emotions get the best of me. Don't let me speak. Don't let me open my mouth and transgress your law. Don't let me take your name in vain. Don't let me do that, Lord. Concerning the works of men, by the word of thy lips, I have kept me from the paths of the destroyer. What's David saying? Listen, if I follow this, then I won't turn into the train wreck. Sometimes we just got it. We want to look at that train wreck. But David knows that it's going to keep him from that. It will keep him from that. It's not that there is a path. When I don't listen, I become a destroyer. And he doesn't want to become that. Hold up my goings in thy paths. I think it's Psalms 25 that says, all the paths of the Lord are mercy and truth. You want to find God? You can only find him on the path of either mercy or truth. That's it. Those are the only two streets you've got, church. That's it. It's the only two you got. If you want to find God, you can find him on either one of those. You start looking on doubt, worry, you know, unbelief, fear, greed, righteousness. You won't find them there. You'll find them on the corner of mercy and truth. I have called upon thee, for thou wilt hear me, O God. Incline thy ear unto me and hear my speech. Listen, he knows that I'm going to God and going to God alone. I take my petition to him. Doesn't also Philippians say that we're supposed to be anxious for nothing? but take all of our prayer and our supplications to God. Church, I'm still working on that verse. Have zero anxiety in your life. That's how you can translate that verse. Have zero anxiety in your life. Have zero worry in your life. Supplication and prayer go to God. I'm still working on that one, church. I got to be honest with you. I mean, chances are I'll be working on it for a while. I'm going to try and get my doctorate. With the good Lord's help, I'll get there. But I'm not there yet, church. I haven't even taken the entrance exam yet. Pray for me. Show thy marvelous loving kindness, O thou that savest by thy right hand them which put their trust in thee from those that rise up against them. I love it. He even qualifies God's loving kindness. It's marvelous. It's not average, church. It's marvelous. It's the best thing you can possibly imagine. It's that double cone with sprinkles. It's marvelous. Marvelous loving kindness. There's exaggeration to God's love and kindness. There's emphasis on it. That's what he is saying here. And he's saying to show it. David wants to see it. Can we pray that prayer? Lord, I want to see your loving kindness. I want that to show up and manifest itself in my life. There's nothing greater than that. And he says, who saves by thy right hand? Who? David knows who's going to save him. God and God alone. He's got a right hand. He can save us. It's big enough to save the world, church. Why would I trust anybody else to save me other than God? It seems silly. It's God and God alone. Amen? He says, keep me as the apple. Keep me as the apple of the eye. Hide me under the shadow of thy wings. He said, keep me as the apple. He didn't say, make me. He said, keep me. Which means, church, we're already there. This is it's already been done. It's already been attained. Keep it. It's like if I hand you something, I say, hey, keep this. Now, the only way you don't have it is if you give it away. Or you can keep it. You say, this is mine. I keep this. Keep me as the apple of your eye. Now, David then has to, what is he saying in that? God, let me give you something to look at. Yes, yeah, is he the center focus of our life and the pupil? And all? Yes, sure, okay. Check, take it. But can there be something more maybe? He's saying, me, David, keep me. Let me give you something to look at, God. Let me give you something. I want to be your wow guy. I want you to look down and say, wow, there goes David. Wow, there goes Phil. Wow, there goes Kent. Wow, there goes Jim. Can God do that? Keep me as the apple of your eye. How do you do that? Well, church, it's simple, right? It's right here. I become the Word. David wanted to become the Word of God. This is his appeal. This is what he's asking him to try. Let this come forth. Let this show forth in my life. Keep me. Church, I don't know about you, but sometimes I just like holding my Bible. I have ever since I was a little boy, I just like holding a Bible. I can't even explain why or what. I don't even understand it, I just like holding a Bible. I like having it. Like, I know the younger generation, they're all electronics and they're online. And praise the Lord. I do use some stuff online, but generally I also have my Word. I just like having it. I don't know. I can't explain it to you. I just like having it. That's what David's saying here. Keep me. I become his Word. I become it. I become the laws, the commandments, however you want to phrase them. I breathe life into it. This is how we remain the apple of God's eye. Wow. There goes my son. Wow. There goes my daughter. Can you imagine God up there? God's up there doing the high five. Yeah! That's my guy! Yeah! I mean, God can't get excited? Seriously? I mean, if we get excited and we're made in his image and his likeness, then he's got to get excited, church. Can we get out of our church heads for just a little bit and see God high five and somebody, yeah! Way to go! Can we see God doing that this morning? I think we can. I think he's doing it. Yeah. Lord, keep us as the apple of your eye. We know who we are. Help us to be that apple. That's what I believe David is saying here. And I love the picture of the eye this morning, too, because I think the eye is, again, there's lots of, I think, symbolisms in the eye, right? Listen, the first thing, you know, as you got to be able to see. Unfortunately, some of us do need glasses, or I can't read. But I gotta be, the eye's got to be open, amen? Amen. Maybe you got to be awake. Call me crazy. If I'm sleeping, my eyes ain't open. But what do they got to be open to? Well, truth. Be open to truth. Don't turn the blind eye. Don't turn the blind eye. What's over there? I don't know. I don't know. No, truth. Don't turn a blind eye. Truth. And what's our vision? It ought to be faith, church. Our vision ought to be faith. Not necessarily what's going on in the world. Oh, I see it. No, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about faith. Can somebody see something a little bit bigger than that? A little bit higher than that? Faith. The eye of faith. The eye of faith has got to look beyond a lot of stuff. Amen? The eye of faith will have to take some appeals to God to have the eyes of faith. Otherwise, it won't be faith. And then if you got eyes, I think you ought to be looking for something. All the smiling people this morning. Didn't he say the Son of Man came to seek and save that which is lost? Yes. Then maybe we ought to go seek somebody that's lost and save them. Ooh, I think you might need some eyes to do that. He didn't say condemn them. He didn't say call them sinner. He didn't say to call them out and say, I know what they're thinking. Is that what he said? He said go seek them and save them. Go seek them and save them. Maybe you need some eyes to do that. And then church, if you're like me, you know, sometimes I got to clean my glasses. We got to keep them free of debris, amen? Didn't he say that, I think, in Matthew, that don't worry about the splinter in your brother's eye until you take the beam out of yours? Keep them free and clean, church. Go get yourself a Kleenex and clean them out. Yeah, here's your Kleenex. Hey, I ain't.
Sorry, church.
That was horrible. Forgive me. Yeah, you can't look at life carnally and just, you're going to point out the obvious and just, that's why you need faith. Don't worry about everybody's splinter. Don't everybody worry about everybody's beam and just don't worry about it. He even said that the one that was calling it out had the greater sin, not the one that you thought was sinning. The one that was calling it out was the greater sinner. They were the worst sinner. That's why your mouth shouldn't transgress, amen? I think it's all connected, right? The Bible's always connected. Verse 10. They are enclosed in their own fat. With their mouths they speak proudly. Who's enclosed in their own fat? Me. I'm self-absorbed. My whole world is evolving all around me. That's why I'm just enclosed in this big body of fat. We're just self-absorbed, man. Can you get past yourself for just a second, Phil? Can you just, and that's why I don't take my appeal to God. Because I know, church, then I got to get past myself. I'm going to take an appeal to him and he's going to say, you know what, Phil, you're right. Let's go get that so-and-so. I know good and well he's not going to do that. What he's going to say is, can you quit being so self-absorbed, Phil? Can you knock it off? I mean, I want to high-five you. I'm not going to high-five you as long as you're going to be self-absorbed. This just in. David knows this. Again, David, the message is always, David, you know, I believe it's for us, but it's got to be an internal message for us. It's got to be the message I believe God's giving to David here in this situation. We'll go to verse 13. Arise, O Lord, disappoint him, cast him down, deliver my soul from the wicked, which is thy sword. Who is God's sword? The wicked. The wicked is God's sword. And what's he doing with the sword? Church, he's just removing some stuff. We talked about that a couple of weeks ago. It's just in his hand. I think it's Isaiah that also says, is the axe going to boast us against the one that swings it? Is the saw going to magnify himself against the one that uses it? No. How God swings his axe, his sword, his saw, whatever he uses to chip away at us, he's going to chip away at us. David knows this. And maybe in this case it was Saul. But he was just chipping away at David. He was chipping away at that self-absorbed person and maybe just trying to trim some of the fat off of me because it messes me up anyway. It doesn't speak righteously. It doesn't praise when I enter his courts. It complains. It finds fault. And so he's saying, arise. So David knows this. Verse 14. From men which are thy hand, O Lord, from men of the world, which have their portion in this life, and whose belly thou fillest with hid treasures, and they are full of children, and leave the rest of their substance to their babes. And again, we're just talking about natural man, and you know, we're looking to fill our belly, but we ain't looking to fill our soul. And church, I don't care what you try and fill it with, if it ain't God, you ain't gonna fill your soul. God's the only one that can fill that soul. But we get into these situations in life and find ourselves empty, or find there's a gap or there's a void, and we think that we'll take our petition, sometimes to a court, to fill that void, to get the favorable response, the void. Because why did I go to court in the first place? Well, I thought there was a void. I thought there was an offense. Right? When you go to court, you got to file a motion. What's a motion? A motion to fight. Right? It's always like Roe v. Wade. Roe versus Wade. What? Ding, ding, ding. The bell's off. Get ready to fight. And doesn't he say that? That the heathen do that. The heathen go to court. The heathen fight. No, but it's a righteous fight. No, he doesn't say it's a righteous fight. He just says if you go to court, you're a heathen. Whether you're right, you could be 100% right as long as you take it to court. He says, didn't he say that we're gonna, the saints are gonna judge this world? Now, it's a spiritual judgment. It's not a natural judgment. It's not like I'm a saint, I go to church, therefore I can take you to court and I know I'm gonna win. You have totally missed the mark and totally missed that scripture. You are perverting the gospel of Jesus Christ. Christians don't go to court. They go where? They appeal to a higher court. They go to God. Because he even tells you in that passage, can't you just suffer? I know you've been defrauded. I know you are right, but can you just suffer this? God actually tells you to suffer it before you take somebody to court. But no, we want to go to court because we think we're right. We think we're the saints. I don't know what we think, church. But it won't fill our soul. I mean, how many folks have gone through a courtroom proceeding? Maybe you won, maybe you lost. Nobody comes out with their soul filled. I don't think anyone ever walks, oh, boy, I tell you what, my soul is, whew, I am totally satisfied. It don't happen. And oftentimes, you probably left worse than you went in. That should be a red flag. And then David says, verse 15, as for me, I will behold thy face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I wake with thy likeness. As for me, as for the church, as for the children of God, I will only be satisfied when I am just like my Father in heaven, righteous. When I have that likeness, when I have that awareness, when I have that understanding, then and only then, as for me. That's David's prayer right there. When it's God and God only. And again, church, it's not going to be apart from righteousness, it's only righteousness. And he says it right there, I will. He's not wondering. He's not saying, he didn't say maybe. I will see the face of God. I will. David believed this. He believed it to be true. He believed it was greater than seeking the riches of the world. That was greater for his children than those. Because again, up here it says that your children be children and their grandchildren. And boy, if that's all we're giving our families, they're going to be empty for a long time to come. But if we'll give them God, if we'll give them his word, if we'll give him that which is eternal, which will fill their soul, I mean, that's the greatest gift that can be given. I was actually in the back this morning with my brother, and my brother has one of my mom's Bibles. My dad gave us each one of my mom's Bibles. And a piece of scripture came to my mind, so I just opened up the Bible. I didn't realize, but it was my mom's Bible. And when I got to the passage of scripture that I was looking for, my mom had notes right at the verse I was looking for. I didn't know that. That was eternal. My mother spoke to me this morning. That's eternal. She's not here with us, but she lives on. It speaks on. It's eternal. I knew exactly what she meant by the notes that she left in that Bible, church. As for me, as for you, when we awake with that kind of righteousness, with that understanding of God. And listen, church, I believe righteousness is, you know, let's not confuse righteousness. You are righteous. But we become righteousness. Just like David, how do we become this apple? It's by being righteous in this world today. Let's take a look, actually. I think it's Psalms 34. Oh, no, I'm sorry. It's not 34. Forgive me. Psalm 35, verse 24. I'm sorry. 35, verse 24. Judge me, O Lord my God, according to thy righteousness. How is he supposed to judge us? According to his righteousness, judge us. We go to we appeal his courtroom. He is the judge. And what are we searching for? We're searching for his righteousness. And let them not rejoice over me. Well, that means, church, then maybe the victory for righteousness might look a little different than we think. Because what's he saying? Not to rejoice. Don't let the enemies rejoice over me. Means they're not going to win. But we're not supposed to fight them either. So what are we supposed to do? I believe so that they won't rejoice. I believe we're just supposed to surrender. You know what the righteous act is? Surrender. Lay it down. Didn't he say that when he was before Pilate? Didn't he say, I lay it down? He didn't take up his life. He took up Pilate's life. He said, I lay it down, but I can take it up again. He laid his down to take up somebody else's. Surrender. There's a fight. Surrender. To me, that's righteousness. Righteousness isn't in the fight. Righteousness isn't, I have the right position, therefore I'm going to win this fight. You win the fight by surrendering. That's how you win. That's righteous. And I find righteousness, church, is often invisible. It's often silent. Because maybe the battle, the only victory is you knowing it and God. Because maybe I surrender that battle before it ever even happens. How about that? What if I surrender that battle before it ever enters a courtroom? What if I surrender that before it ever even happens? What if that's how you put points on the board? What if that's how you have the victory? And I believe that's what it is. I believe it's laying it down. What if it's you know, to reward good instead of evil? What if maybe I have to surrender that thought of repaying evil for evil? Maybe I have to surrender that thought and instead reward good. Didn't David do that with Saul when Saul was trying to kill him, remember? And Saul could have killed him. David could have killed him. David's men told him to kill him. The world will tell you to kill him. The world will tell you to take him to court. God won't. The world will. And what happened when Saul entered that cave, I don't know, maybe David did think about it, because he did cut a piece of his robe off. And then what did he do after he cut the robe off? He felt like garbage. He chased down Saul and he said, Master. He called him Master. He explained what happened to him. He said he was sorry. And then you know what Saul said to David? He's like, because he was surrendering, essentially. Saul could have taken him at that moment and killed him. And that's what he was out there doing. He was looking to find David to kill him. But David surrendered. Didn't have to. Could have easily killed him. But he surrendered. And I believe God not only worked in David's life, he worked in Saul's life, because then Saul said, you are more righteous than me, David. You have rewarded me good when I rewarded you evil. That's righteous. You want to be righteous? Just reward good. The only reward you can give from this day forward, church, is good. God says you're righteous. It's not rewarding evil. It's not rewarding bad. Even in the face of perhaps your own death. And he said, can you do me one more favor, David? Sure. Sure, Master. What is it? Will you protect my seed? Will you bless my seed? Saul knew he was going to die. David said, yes, I will. And what happened? His grandson, Mephibosheth, he sat at the king's table forever. He always had a place at David's table. The very man that wanted to kill him, his grandson sat at that table in his house. Not just, hey, I'll send you a Christmas card. I'll send you a fruit basket. He sat at David's table every day and ate with David and his family. Essentially became David's family. You understand? That's what made him righteous. You see, and righteousness will keep a vow. It won't break a vow. Because once Saul died, did David have to keep that vow? No, only him and Saul knew about it. The grandson wasn't even born yet. He didn't know about it. Righteousness will keep a vow. It won't break the vow. Even if you don't like the outcome of the circumstance, you'll still keep the vow. See, that's righteous. Righteous is keeping the vow. Maybe that's why he says, till death do you part. Maybe that's a righteous act, to remain married. Is that possible? What is it? It's righteous to get a divorce? Well, that's a righteous act of God. That's ridiculous. You're not keeping a vow. And there might be some pain in keeping the vows. Can I get an amen? No, you keep the vow. And then I believe, church, that, you know, we will only worship God and worship God alone. That to me, is the righteous act. We won't serve idols. David knew he had some idols inside of himself. We all have idols inside of ourselves. And if you listen to it, you worship it. Whether that's anger, whether that's fear, whether that's greed, whether, I don't know what your idol is this morning. I know I got some, and I keep asking God to swing the axe and take them down. Swing the axe and take them down. He's going to use a sword and an axe and every other instrument he needs to take the idols down, because they mess us up, church. They mess us up. Until we worship the true and the living God and not this false idol that dwells inside of me and tells me that, you know, no, I'm going to go to, I'm doing this. I am going to fight you. I don't know what we do. See, that's not righteous. That's emotional. I don't think you can be righteous and emotional. Can I love and be righteous? Yes. Let's not confuse this. But can I let the emotions have the best of me and be righteous at the same time? I don't know. I probably won't have Saul's grandson sitting at my kitchen table eating dinner with me. I think when the emotions get the best of me, I tell him to get out of my house. You ain't eating at my table. But if I let righteousness rule in my life, if I remain the apple of God's eye and he high-fives me, you know when he high-fives me? When Mephibosheth walks through my house and sits down and I give him the best spot and I give him, can I give him the better steak? God says, hey, that's my boy. Bam! Gives me a high five. And then he says it right here, verse 28. And my tongue shall speak of thy righteousness and of thy praise all day long. How long am I praising him? Oh, all day long. So maybe my position of surrender ought to have a sweet little song attached to it. Maybe it ought to sound real nice and sweet. Maybe I shouldn't be, you know, begrudging and complaining and, well, we all have our cross to bear. Man, can we park that verse for a while? I mean, I know I have said that more times than I can count. The Lord said, I know, you told me. A zillion times. Can you park that verse already? I know you carried the cross. Thanks. Thanks. Kudos to you. Can we sing about it, though? Can we surrender and sing about it? I mean, I believe we can. I believe it's in Revelation, I think it's 19, where he says that he is faithful and true, and he comes with the armies of the Lord, and they're on a white horse, and all the armies are behind him. They're also in white horses, and they're in white robes. And what do they have? Nothing but a white robe, church. Yet somehow they win the battle.
No sword in hand, no gun, no knife, nope, just a horse and a white robe.
I don't know, call me crazy, but maybe that's just a white flag of surrender. How do you win the battle?
Man, I get behind Jesus Christ and we go riding into battle and we say, we surrender. We surrender.
What battle?
What battle? How do you do that? He goes on, he says that we'll devour the kings and the princes, and we're not eating people. What are we eating? We're eating this idea, this thought that wants me to retaliate and fight. You swallow that down and you put on your white robe and you ride in and you surrender. The whole church was with him. He wasn't by himself. There was an army behind him. That means there had to be some of us along for the ride. Amen? Amen.
I say we mount up and ride in, man. Ride into battle. What do? You surrender.
I think, what movie was that? Was that Dances with Wolves? Remember when they had that battle scene? And Kevin Costner, it was like, they was battling on for days and days and days. And Kevin Costner couldn't take it. He was bloody, and he just got on the horse and rode right in the middle of the battlefield like this. And they was trying to shoot at him, and they couldn't hit him. And he just rode through. He rode through a second time. They still couldn't hit him. He's just like this, like, put me out of my misery. Couldn't hit him. Guess what happened? Battle ended.
One man had enough faith, was brave enough. Didn't pick up a sword. Didn't pick up a gun. Just total surrender. I mean, if you think the righteousness of God is anything else but the position of surrender, we don't understand the gospel of Jesus Christ. We don't understand the righteousness of God. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled, not empty.
Filled. It's a promise. When we hunger and thirst for righteousness, we'll be filled. When we surrender, when we say, I won't fight, when we say, come sit at my table, when I take my appeal to a higher court, I will be filled. You'll be filled with what? With God. With God. When we pursue that, that's our pursuit. Then that's when God's high-fiving us. Yeah, yeah, you're getting it now. You're getting it now.
I think that's what's going on. I think that's the righteousness of God. I think once we start to feed that, right? If you feed something, like if you get a stray cat or a dog, you feed it, what happens? It keeps on coming back, right? And you feed it long enough, what happens? It gets bigger and bigger and bigger. You keep feeding me, that's what happens to me. I get bigger and bigger. I usually have a smile on my face. Listen, whatever you feed will grow. Let us be fed by the righteousness of God. That will grow stronger. That will rise up. That's what we feed. That's what we feed one another. I believe that's done with a song in our heart, though. That's victory. It's not victory with, you're not just getting by, church. No one's just getting by. Ask the worship team if they'll come. I pray let that song sing out, that you'll enter his gates with thanksgiving and enter his courts with praise. Declare his righteousness. Declare the victory. Amen. Why don't you stand while we close out?